And Joey is our loading screen character today. Hello everyone, welcome back to Let's Break the Frick Out of Suikoden 2. I am SIMSteven, also known as Mr. Fenrel. And yes, we are breaking the frick out of Suikoden 2. Just look at my levels. Level 35 across the board. Not counting Humphrey and Futch, of course, because they joined at level 52. But yes, we are sequence breaking the game. Sad to say it, we're not doing a traditional Let's Play and all that. But then again, I never really been one to do that, really. So, we're going to buy a bunch of rare finds here in the Highway Village. I already did my soft resetting and stuff off screen. And like I said, once you actually check the shop, it'll be set until about 30 minutes or an hour has passed in game time. In addition to that, we got, I believe, teriyaki recipe and rabbit plans too, which, you might guess, plans are another collectible for our castle once we eventually get it. And speaking of collectibles, yes, the game did prove me to be a liar last episode. There are no items hidden lying around in this village. However, eventually we'll be able to recruit another character who is also the recipient of more collectibles, and once we recruit that character, there will be someone standing right here, which you can buy said collectibles for. We're not going to go over that in detail. I'm not even going to tell you about it, but I am just saying there is something there for us later once we actually get that person. Anyways, we're off to the world map, and these are the ones I really did my grinding on. There's another enemy out here on the world map that are like shadow armor dudes. They are just from the original Suikoden 1 game, but they got re-updated in this game. But the reason why you want to grind on these guys if you do the Muse-Matilda glitch is these guys do not attack the back row, and you can safely put your weaker characters like Nami, Joey, and Ryu in the back row, and they won't get one-shotted by the enemies if they're in the back. Well, most of the time. Rikimaru had to stick it out for a little while, just not getting killed right off the bat. But while we're exploring the capital of the Matilda region, this is known as Rock X Castle. I don't know where Matilda comes from because there are no major landmarks or cities or anything like that that go by the name of Matilda, so that's just the name of the region, I suppose. Anywho, one thing I also did off-screen was set this shop up so that I could buy a couple Thunder God garbs, which are really good defensive item, even though Nanami is the only one who can equip them at this point in time in the game. Defense plus 25, hit plus 10, resist lightning. Speaking of resist lightning, where's Rikimaru? There's Rikimaru. When we're in Highway Village, I bought a thunder amulet from the shop there as a rare find. So, just gonna update Rikimaru's armor, as well as... Wait, what are you doing with brass armor? I could buy that where I am now normally in Ryubi Village. we're going to buy Rikimaru some good defensive gear, as good as we can get, really. Because up ahead, we've got a optional boss. And said optional boss is going to cream us because we don't really have decent healing. So, we're going to try and beef up all of our defenses as much as possible before we get there. And that is really tempting, to have that extra magic defense plus 10, because much like the bosses in Suikoden 1, bosses are designed to be fought, or most bosses are at least, designed to be fought with 6 characters, which means they tend to have a ton of HP and group attacks, meaning they attack your entire party all at once, and it's a really bad thing if one of your characters goes down, because then you're short a party member, and, well, just things will not go your way at that point in time in the fight, and it's all downhill from there. Nothing at the item shop I want right now. I might as well actually check the thing, so when we actually get our headquarters, we'll actually be able to buy the stuff from these shops. Once we get that far in the game, you know, we recruit characters that become shopkeepers in our headquarters, and every time you look at the inventory of a shop later in the game, you'll be able to buy whatever you've seen from other shops throughout the course of the game. Now, additionally, there should be a violence room here. I believe all that does is make it so you go berserk after a certain amount of turns in battle. I'm not entirely sure. I believe that's... Or maybe it's a different status effect. I don't think it's berserk, actually. But I'm going to go back down here. Now, speaking of runes, I did go back to Muse, and I bought a Titan rune for Rick and Mario. I attached a bunch of other runes that I've collected to everyone else. So, Ryu has Earth rune, Joey has a Fire rune, and I gave him one of my Fury runes that I bought from the rare finds in Muse. What I wanted to do was try and get a Water rune for Nanami, but I'm using another setup here, the Fury Double Beat combination. What this does is allows her to be in Berserk all the time, and she attacks twice per turn. And since Nanami hits two at a time, does two small hits rather than one singular hit like Joey would, she can hit four times per battle, but then again they're like half damage per hit. So it's basically two regular hits at extremely high power. I think I want to attach that violence in the Gale rune to a couple other characters. Violence to Ryu. And Gale to Joey. Now I'm going to have to make sure and unequip these two runes, because eventually Joey and Ryu will get their own special runes, and I'm not entirely sure if they'll lose the runes on their right hands when they get, well, any runes they have equipped on their right hands once they get their special runes, because those special runes will obviously be unequippable and permanent throughout the course of the game, kind of like how the Soul Eater was in Suikoden 1. And I'm going to go off on a tangent and talk to this guy right here, since, well, he's in front of us and all that, and he's obviously a recruitable character since he has a facial portrait and a name. I believe LC Chan stands for Long Chan Chan. I believe that's his full name. Strong body is the root of any great fighter, and the root of any great body is eating great food. Stop it! Okay, I accidentally hit the X button again. Just kind of scroll through a little too fast. Anyways, we're done with Rock Axe. There's nothing to spoil there, and speaking of spoilers, this whole side quest we're doing is not spoilers for this game in particular, but there are just, you know, it kind of tells a little bit of a story from Suikoden 1 in a nutshell. It's kind of an abridged version. And I think I'll kind of explain it while we're going up Mount Rakute, because this is a bonus dungeon with a bonus boss at the end, and it's all for the purposes of side quests of recruiting these two characters. But dialogue and stuff. Lord Ryu, please be careful. Monsters are looking everywhere, and the whole lord deal. Yeah, we're not exactly lord. He's not exactly a lord just yet. I mean, he's still just a kid who got kidnapped twice from the mercenaries in the Mercenary Fortress region, and he escaped once and gone back to Kyaro, and then got kidnapped again by Victor and all that. Then again, we've kind of been willingly kidnapped the second time because we were about to get lynched at our hometown because they declared us spies and all that. So we're still kind of more like fugitives on the run from our own home country, and we haven't achieved lordship through all the story events that will come later. Then again, that's kind of the point of... Well, it's not exactly the point of sequence breaking, but you know, I'm getting off on topic here. Alright, let's just read the text. Hold on, Kent. We're coming to save you. We're coming to save you. And there's a bit of a mist barrier that's pushing us off this mountain. This mist. What's going on? We'll never make it now if you don't hurry, Kent. What is it? A magic barrier? What should we do? Black, please help me, Black. The mist is receding. Did you do that, Sir Ryu? Rune's power, let's go. Again, a special rune that we don't actually possess because we sequence broke to this point in time in the game. So yeah, you got a glimpse of what it looks like, even though we're technically not supposed to have it. We're technically supposed to have it, but we don't because we're kind of cheating the game here. If I'm not mistaken, these Hawkmen, I believe they drop another collectible, but I'm not going to do a whole heck of a lot of fighting here on the mountain. Because, like I said, I don't have a dedicated healer, and I'm going to have to heal off all damage with medicines, which is why I bought a couple before we got going on this. But, well, speaking of spoilers and all that and from the first game, I feel it's at least worth talking about, you know, why Humphrey and Futch are way off the beaten path from the Tauren Republic, and how they're all recurring characters from the first game and all that. So, To put things in a nutshell, without, or at least an abridged version of what's happened up to this point, during the course of events of Suikoden 1, Futch lost his dragon. Going back a little bit further, Futch is a dragon knight, and dragon knights are born in an area where there's a dragon cave nearby. And the whole dragon's den, dragon's knight thing is that if you want to be a resident of the dragon's den, you have to have your own dragon. So everyone in the dragon's den basically is a dragon knight. Now, during the course of Suikoden 1, Futch lost his dragon, bit of an old sacrifice play and all that, and because he no longer has his dragon, he had been exiled from the Dragon's Den Fortress, because, well, that's just their law and all that, and, well, he can no longer be a dragon's knight because he no longer has a dragon. Kind of makes sense, I suppose. But Humphrey is a friend of Joshua, who is the leader of the Dragon's Den. And Joshua had asked Humphrey to watch over Futch, because Futch was very young. I believe he was just a teenager. There it is, right there. Turtle Plans number 3, so we got our plans. So Futch lost his dragon. Humphrey decided to essentially mentor Futch and watch over him, and they decided to go off on an adventure after the events of Suikoden 1. The Tauren Republic won their war against the Scarlet Moon Empire, and now Humphrey and Futch are off on an adventure or journey to find another dragon for Futch. That's kind of why they're off here. And back in the inn, Humphrey had also said that they're on the way to Harmonia, because Harmonia is a magical kingdom, basically the giant superpower of this world. And, well, they are essentially very, well, because they're a magical kingdom, I believe that was their best bet to find a dragon, which obviously are magical beings of sorts. That's kind of why they were off going through, passing through the Jousting region and going off that way. I suppose they figured that it was their best bet to find a dragon for Futch. So that's kind of a bit of a summary of how we got from there to here. Now, they kind of join up with us after the end of this scenario, and I don't know where to go with that, but We're doing all this just to get them to join our army and all that for a while, because they are 108 stars of destiny in this particular game, so we definitely want to get them to join up with us at some point. And I think I'm going back too far. Looking to try and get all the items off of this mountain, because even though we can come back here later, I definitely don't want to come back to this mountain later if I can avoid it. Because I got the turtle plants for those Hawkmen, I've got all the missiles on this mountain, because I think at the end of the game, when you have the ability to go anywhere, and essentially you've conquered the entire region of this world, I believe the encounters change here, and I'm at least trying to get all the items from this place, so I have no reason to come back here later. Alright, there we go. Dragon plans number 2. We get a lot of plans around here. Ah, okay. So, I suppose as we're on our way up to the mountain, I do want to let everyone know that I am going to be doing the rest of this Let's Play with these completely broken, overleveled characters I have. Although I will try to avoid using Futch and Humphrey as much as possible. There's one point in time in the game where your party is randomized, and you have to go through a whole dungeon, a number of events before you can get access to all your party members again. So I'm probably going to soft reset at that point in time in the game if they join up with me randomly. But other than that, I'm going to try to avoid abusing all these overleveled characters I've got. But that doesn't really justify anything with Ryu, Joy, and Nanami, since they're essentially the big three characters of this game. Joy, not so much, but on our side at least. You'll understand what I mean by that later, unless you play through the game, but Ryu and Nanami are going to be overleveled for a good chunk of the game, and they're pretty much going to be required for a lot of crap. Now, I'm probably going to get called out on this, saying, "Oh, you're a cheater, you exploiter. How can you do a good walkthrough and let's play if you're just going to abuse a glitch like this to overlevel your party to be like half the typical max at the very beginning of the game?" And I've got something to say about that, since we're kind of here. Hold on a second, gotta save the game. Alright, I've got actually a number of things to say to crits who might call me out on that. First of all, I have to beat this boss in order to make Humphrey and Futch permanent party members. So I've got to do a very challenging boss with very limited healing abilities. So you see I have no water rune, and that one special rune that Ryu is supposed to have also has healing spells on it. So this fight is going to be very difficult for me to complete. That's why I brought along a couple items for me to use in this fight. Joey, you've got this. Let's give you that. Let's also give Nanami one of those. Actually, Nami, I'm going to give you Kindness Drop Scroll. Futch, I'm going to give you the other Protect Mist. I bought these as rare finds from Highway Village, and I'm going to need those, because I am very wary about a particular spell that one of our enemies, this boss is going to be, might be able to spam. It's obviously random and all that, but I have to pass this very difficult boss fight before I can actually abuse these high levels, as well as use Futch and Humphrey regularly, because one thing about them is if they leave your party, I believe they go back to Highway Village, and the story that's, well, if we go all the way back to the Mercenary Fortress with them until they haven't officially joined us until we complete this boss fight. So, once I beat this boss fight, they'll officially join, but I can't actually use them throughout the course of the early game unless I actually complete this fight, and it's going to kick my ass probably a few times before I actually get through here. So I can't exactly abuse high levels early game, with the exception of Joy, Denami, and Ryu. And I'll go over other reasons for that later. I plan to do a bit of exploration after this whole side quest is over. For now, though, let's get back to the side quest. Back to the story. Kent, that's Kent over there. Wait. Heard a screech. And we got Harpy. We got a Harpy. Alright. So, the way I'm going to go about doing this fight is I'm going to spam Titan Rune with Rikimaru. And I'm going to use other abilities with all these other characters as well. Humphrey is going to attack every turn. Futch is going to put up Protect Mist. Ryu, first turn, we're going to do Canopy Defense. Joy, I bought this Fire Rune for a reason. He already has level 4 magic, thanks to his high level, which is based on your magic stat. How many MP levels you gain is based on your magic stat, and I think Joey has already over 100 magic. Now he's level 35. Nanami, you're just going to attack every single turn. So this first round, I'm going to set up a bunch of defensive barriers. The Protect Mist is a level 2 water magic spell, and it does basically the same thing as what Ryu is going to be using here in a second. What it does is it has a chance to defend your entire party, or they will individually defend themselves from magic attacks. Canopy Defense, however, does 100% of the time, but it only does it once. So I'm going to stack these up in case this boss uses essentially a whirlwind attack of sorts. Which, thankfully, he doesn't. He has a couple single target attacks. If I'm not mistaken, that will unbalance a character. If it has a chance to unbalance the character. And I believe Oh, there it goes right there. I believe the Harpy also has the ability to just do straight up damage with a Talon attack. Now, Rikimaru has a bit of a disadvantage here because he's slow and he uses his Titan Rune every turn. And I just have to hope that the Harpy does not unbalance him all the time. Bag, Thunder Runner, I'm going to use that. Ryu here is going to Clay Guardian Rikimaru. And I'm going to eventually Clay Guardian everyone. That just basically raises defense, and I'm not sure if the tornado attack that this Harpy uses is defense-based or magic-based, but I'm hoping I don't have to find out on this. Joy, use Protect Mist on us. Now that your explosion is over. And now we just attack. The reason I'm going to be using Titan Rune on Rikimaru is, for one, I doubt he's going to be faster than the Harpy at all throughout the course of this battle. But also, the main reason I'm going to be using the Titan Rune with Rikimaru is I'm pretty sure you cannot be counterattacked if you use a weapon skill rune like the Titan Rune. I believe it can be dodged, but I don't believe it can be counterattacked. And my biggest concern in this fight is going to be taking too much damage, since I do not have a dedicated healer. And now we did a good crit there just a second ago. Whenever the screen zooms in like that, you can pretty much bet it's a critical hit. She did 300 damage. So that's good. I didn't give you anything like that. Alright, Humphrey does not need to use any medicines. Futch wasted a turn to use take that Thunder Runner out. I hope it actually does decent damage and all that. I'm gonna give Revenge Earth to Rikimaru and Futch now. 100% counterattack to Allie. Not only does this help with doing more damage and counterattacking, but it also increases dodge chance, so I could evade damage completely sometimes thanks to that. Might not always get a counterattack, but taking no damage is better than taking some. And we're witnessing more high level fire magic. And I kind of like the spell animation in this game. A lot better than the first game, definitely. Still gotta compliment this game on how much better it looks compared to the first. Alright, so let's see how much damage this thing does. Oh, by the way, in case you're wondering why I didn't put any runes on Humphrey and Futch, it's because you can't, unfortunately. Until they become permanent party members, you cannot change their runes, you cannot change their equipment, nothing really. And one other thing I'm really worried about, which I still haven't brought up to this point, is that there are no blacksmiths in this region. So I believe Ryu still has a level 3 Tonfa. Nanami's weapon is level 3. I believe Joey's weapon is still level 3. And Rikimaru's weapon is still level 5. So they're not only do I have limited healing here, but I'm doing a lot less damage than I'm supposed to be. Which is really bad that this thing keeps making Futch and Humphrey unbalanced. Futch, I guess you're going to be on healing duty this turn. On yourself, you're the one who really needs it. Vengeurth, Futch, and I'm going to do Humphrey next turn as well. Or should I do Clay, or the defense one? Yeah, probably do the defense one next turn. Alright, so here we go. By the way, yes, you just saw that multiple spell effects can happen at the same time. So Futch used his medicine on him, and Joy used his spell. I believe they do that just to speed things along, because they don't interfere with each other. I can see there's a lot of things that do interfere with each other, such as spells and all that, and attacking the same target with two different people. Oh! Great. There we go. That's the one attack I'm trying to avoid as much as possible. And why I use two protect miss scrolls. Now I was able to avoid damage from that once already. But I may not be so lucky later on in the fight. I have two protect miss spells stacked, so that should help me avoid damage a little bit better. But no guarantees on this. Play Guardian. I think I used that first on Rikimaru. So we're going to beef up Futch and Rikimaru mostly because Humphrey probably will not go down for the life of him. And if worse comes to worse, Humphrey will probably solo the rest of the fight by himself. He just does not take damage whatsoever. I mean, he's been getting hit a lot, and he's been taking like one damage every single turn. He is that much of a freaking tank in here. So, yeah, he is just badass with all his defense. And he does some decent damage too. Not as much as some characters would, but yeah, he's just worth it. Alright, doing some good damage. There goes my Revenge Earth. Oh crap. By the way, in case you haven't noticed already, yeah, this Harpy, it can attack twice in a turn. It always attacks twice in one turn, so. Yeah, something they also gave bosses in this game is the ability to attack several times per turn. That can really screw you over, because then again, well, it's 6 versus 1. They had to change it up somehow. Humphrey, do some damage. I think I'm going to start using some medicines on this turn, because 2 tornadoes in a row can really, really screw you over. Guardian. Joey's weakest. Who did Futch use his medicine on? I'm gonna have him use it there. And Joey. Joey medicine. Ryu. Nanami. Actually, Nanami, she's gonna attack. I'll use some more healing next turn. kind of want to save those kindness drops in case one of my frontliners, one of their hit points drops really low. And I'm going to try and beef up Nanami's defense next turn as well. Once again, I don't know if that tornado attack is physical or magical based. It's probably magical based, but it doesn't hurt to put up more defenses and buffs because you only get one life unless you buy some sacrificial Jizos, which I did not buy even though they were in the item shop. I knew I forgot something. Okay, you attack. Nanami needs healing the most. Nanami needs defense the most. No, I'm gonna heal with Joey this turn. You go heal Futch. And Nanami, you attack. Alright, and after this, I am probably going to put up Revenge Earth on Humphrey, and I might beef Ryu's defenses a little, as well as Humphrey's. And I think I'll be set for the rest of the fight. Come on, Protect Mist, you can defend me better than that. Yeah, and proc'd once this fight. By the way, that's the reason I gave Nanami that sun badge, which is a rare find in the item shop in Muse, if not mistaken. That's when I actually made that mistake of going to the wrong shop to buy my Fury runes. Earth rune, Avenger on Humphrey. Joey heal yourself. Nanami heal Ricky Mario. This is kind of why I got that kindness drop scroll, because I believe it's a full heal. If not a very strong heal. 382. And that got him back to full, I'm pretty sure. Oh, and it's also said attack up. Does that also boost attack as well? Then again, these descriptions are not that great, but it's supposed to be counterattack. I don't know if counterattack up is what it meant to say, but then again, limited graphic sprites, something they did not really do very well. At least it did something. Attack, Futch. Healing. Nanami needs healing, and Futch, I think, is actually faster than her because he's about 20 levels higher. Right. Play Guardian on myself. Firewall. I think we start attacking again. I forget all who I buff for the defense. So I am. Yeah, I believe it's called Clay Guardian. I forget who I buffed for that defense there. So I might. I'm pretty sure I did out the whole back row. I'm pretty sure I did Ricky Mark. I think I had 6 MP, level 1 MP. So. Pretty sure I buffed Ricky Maru early, but I'm not entirely sure if I did or not. Yeah, not getting counterattack, but he can miss. So it's good that he's not taking extra damage. But heal yourself. Pretty sure I haven't used this on Humphrey yet, so I'm gonna use it on Futch. Firewall. Nope, no one else needs healing. So, suppose we're good here. The And this thing is going to take a long time to take down, if not mistaken. It's been how many rounds so far? So yeah, it's probably going to take quite a while to beat this thing. Oh! Berserk. Were you berserk there for a second? Was that the violence rune coming into play? Oh! There it goes! And the berserk for Ryu just didn't happen. It was completely useless. But I made it out of that fight with everybody alive, which got a fist pump and congratulate myself for that because I don't have any dedicated healers. I had to use medicine this whole time. You came to save me, Futch? There's no dragons here. That rumor was total bull. You should know better, Kent. But what if there was? And if I had a friend who has a dragon knight, I could be proud. That's why. And I heard it. The dragon knight everyone else talked about. It's real. And it's just above here. That's why I ran up here. Then I fell and twisted my leg. Oh, so it wasn't the harpy that did that. Yeah, okay, that's good. It's okay now. There, you see? How did you get through here? Look, it's Black Scale, the charm Futch gave me when I prayed to it, the mist lifted. So there must be a dragon here. So what you're saying is the mist that prevented us from entering and spoiled Ryu's rune, or at least the graphic of it, was actually the doing of a dragon who was nesting here on this mountain. Hmm, that's interesting theory. Let's see how it holds up. Black Scale, so that's what. What's important is that you're safe. Let's go home. No, Futch. I said I heard the dragon's cry. Last night, there was a tremendous beating of wings and a crack and cry that could split stone. It was just ahead. It might be a dragon knight right there. A dragon right there. Let's see. Not a dragon knight. Whoops. There's no way there'd be a dragon around here. And if there was... What if there is? Even if there was... Let's go see. Lord Ryu, will you stay with us a bit longer? There's no dragon here. There's no dragon here. He's in denial. Come on, hurry up, Futch. Well, we're gonna drag you along, Futch. That's... I was right! It's an egg! A dragon's egg! It has to be! Dragons only lay their eggs in dragon caves. Then what's that? There's no other egg that looks like that. This, you could be a real dragon knight again. Dragon's egg. Captain Joshua of the Dragon Knights once told me, even though dragons lay eggs in dragon caves, once in a wild dragon appears. If we could find out why, we could probably breed new tribes of dragons. I was headed to the Great Shrine Crystal Valley, try and find more about that. Kind of like what I said, Crystal Valley is a part of Harmonia. But I never expected that in a place like this. Quickly, come over here, Futch. But... Look at it, Futch, it's a new dragon! No! I don't need a dragon. Lord Tickdoll. Kent, they were also nice to me. Tickdoll is a glitch, by the way, caused by data transfer. It should be Mickdoll, or even Tyr, but that's who we're referring to as the hero of the first game. Everyone is also concerned about me and hoping they could help me fight another dragon. That's why I couldn't tell them the truth. I don't want to ride on a dragon. Any dragon besides Black, he was the only one for me. And now Humphrey's got an idea. So I guess you don't need this egg or the beast to sleep inside. I'll use my sword to destroy it. What? Why? What's going on? Why would you do that? Dragon pups are weak creatures. With no mother or knight to care for it, it will weaken and die. And if it did live, but without a master, it would be no more than a monster that would terrorize humans. That's why you need to care for it! Come on, Futch, stop him! Stop him, Futch! Then you stop it, mister. It's a dragon's egg. After all we've gone through. Wait, Sir Humphrey. Just gotta say, ain't that the cutest thing? A little baby white dragon, so cute, and he's got a really cute little cry. It's a dragon, it's so small. Futch? Never seen such a small dragon, and even never even heard of a white dragon. But it's still a dragon, right? Yeah, it has to be, don't you think so, Futch? But I don't need... Then why stop me, Futch? It wouldn't be betrayal to have a new dragon. My memories of Black's death are precious, but I wouldn't have to forget that. And it's no reason to close a door to the future.
I love that line, by the way.
No reason to close a door on the future, indeed.
Futch!
There's nothing to be afraid of. Come here. I christen thee Bright. The first black and now bright, and it's a white one too, so maybe it's a sign of things to come.
Stay tuned for Suikoden 3.
Thank you, Lord Ryu. If I would like to repay your favor, if we can ever be of assistance to you, please ask. Would you fight with us? Of course, for you I will wield the sword again. I, Futch, former 9th ranked Dragon Knight, will fight by your side. So naturally, there's going to be a war, and we're going to be fighting it, and that's what they're going to be fighting for us. But then again, we sequence broke the game, so that war exactly isn't in progress yet. But then again, same formula as Suikoden 1 for the most part, so we kind of already know how things are going to play out eventually. It's just how we get to that point.
Fight hard, Futch!
Don't worry about me, Kentei. Next time we meet, I'll be a Dragon Knight again.
Really? Don't forget your promise!
I won't. Okay.
Okay, I almost forgot. It's Black Scale. I'll give it back now.
You keep that, Kent, as proof of my promise.
Really? Is it really okay? Wow, I'll treasure it. And I look forward to the day you come with your dragon.
You do that, and I swear I'll return as a Dragon Knight. Let's go. Yeah, take it easy, Kent.
Bye, Futch!
Alright, and now they've officially joined our party. And they get placed in the back row for whatever reason. Always good to check that whenever it says you want to change formation, because stuff like that might happen. Alright. Yes, officially joined us! Alright, so a couple of Suikoden 1 veterans have joined back with us. And now we're overpowered as frick to break the rest of the early game here. Alright, stay. And I suppose we'll save. Alright, didn't need to show me saving there. But, I think at this point, that we're fully healed and all that, I think we should rearrange our gear now that we've got no reason for a bunch of these items that... medicines back on and stuff, and actual gear. And I did not even equip a couple of the items that I got in the mountain. I don't think we need that thunder amulet on Riki Maru now. So we're going to give him the skill ring that we picked up on the mountain. Tech plus 20, definitely needed for a guy like Riki Maru who misses a lot. Like I said, I love him. He's got a ton of HP, but he's like Babe Ruth. He misses a lot if you don't buff his skill a bunch with equipment and stuff. So, also, his defenses are usually pretty low. So giving him a lot of defensive equipment actually allows him to utilize that massive HP pool that he has. Beyond that... Joy Gauntlet. Anything good for Ryu? He's already got a thunder amulet, so let's give Futch one. And let's give him some of those boots since he's over leveled. Ryu, we're gonna give you that for a cape and boost your defense. And Nami's pretty good. Okay, I think we're got a good setup going here. So let's sell off the old unused equipment that we have now. Oh, and some rare finds refreshed. I don't need this single stack of a medicine. It's kind of pointless. I'm gonna take that Thunder God garb for the road. You can tell we're probably gonna give that to a future party member or pass it around, I suppose. I'm not really sure. By the way, I never actually explained the medicine room. We actually had Tuda at the beginning of the game, and he had one equipped. But essentially what the medicine room does is, during battle, if a member of your party reaches critical hit point status, a character with medicine room will automatically use medicine on that party member and sacrifice what you might have entered for their normal turn. It can be useful if you need healing in a pinch and you're about to get hit by another enemy. But other than that, I don't really use it all that much. Now, where we are right now is the Matilda Greenhill pathway, or forest path, or border. Whatever you like to call it. And I just got a recipe from that fight. Guess I don't need to fight those things anymore. Around here, there are a lot of enemies that drop collectibles, and that's kind of why I'm going backwards through this pathway back to Green Hill. And you can kind of get an idea of how all these regions connect. Green Hill, as we saw, is that area west of the Muse region. Attack, attack, attack. I'm going to use my buddy attack on this group because I do not want them getting a 6 enemy unite attack on me. Yes, enemies can use unite attacks as well, which is a bad thing if you have 6 enemies, because 6 enemy unite attacks tend to be devastating. Although I might show it off one of these days, just not right now. But as I was saying before, this pathway has a lot of collectibles, and there's one of them right there. So, I've been getting one like every single fight here, so that's a good sign. And those big trees in back. Those also have collectibles, if I remember right. I believe those little elves we fought in the last battle also have another collectible. Pretty sure they have a recipe, but I'm not entirely 100% sure. But these guys, I know they have a collectible that I'm going to try and get and fight these guys every time I get a chance. And that's kind of the whole point of why I went on an adventure last episode. I was trying to just go around and get a bunch of collectibles and just dump them into my warehouse so I don't have to collect them later, or having them clog up my inventory through a good chunk of the early game. Because you're not going to have a warehouse for forever until you get your headquarters. That's not what I wanted, but I'll take it. Heavy necklace, if I remember right, is a item that kobolds can equip. And I think only kobolds can equip. Speaking of quips, we got a dragon armor in that chest back there. And I give that to Ryu. It is one of the best defensive items he can get at this point in time in the game. If we were playing through it normally, that is. But yeah. What was I saying? Yeah, the warehouse is not available for a good chunk of the early game. I mean, it is available now at the Mercenary Fortress, but stuff will happen and it'll become unavailable for a while. And that's the main reason why I've been going around getting collectibles. So I can dump them in the warehouse, and so they won't clog up my inventory during the times when I don't have access to the warehouse. Which is kind of why I'm going backwards through this pathway, instead of going all the way around using the Muse-Matilda border glitch again to get back to Muse and then back to the Mercenary Fortress area. Also, there is one other area that I'd like to show in Green Hill itself. Because when I was going around to the rune shop in Muse between episodes, I did think of something to try and get another water, to try and get a water rune, not another one, for Nanami. But unfortunately, there is, despite the fact that there is a rune shop in Green Hill, it doesn't carry anything for, you know, water magic runes. However, it does have a rare find that I want to try and get. And while we're there, I gotta make sure to unequip the Gale rune that I put on Joey and the Violence rune that I put on Ryu. Because that Violence rune, I think there's only like one in the game, maybe two. I don't know if there's possible to get it as a rare find or a drop, so I'm pretty sure I'm screwed if I lose that one. And the Gale runes, like I've said before, are something that are missable. Now, we got a guy here. I'm going to talk to him just for a sec, or try to. He doesn't say anything. But he is another one of the 108 Stars of Destiny, and I might meet the requirements for recruiting him. What you need to do is have an animal in your party, and you might need to have your castle at a certain size. I'm not entirely sure if that's a requirement or not. Basically, you get enough recruits, and your headquarters grows in size. And if the headquarters grows in size to a certain point, you might be able to recruit more characters. And I think he has that as one of his requirements, because recruiting that guy leads to more recruits. And, well, just like, well, we already see Muku Muku, and if I go back to the Mercenary Fortress and go all the way back around, I might be able to recruit him. But right now, going back to the Mercenary Fortress means I have to go back through Toto to get back here. And that probably means I'm going to progress with the story at that time in the game. So naturally, I'm going to avoid doing that and trying to recruit him, but I might try and come back later using the glitch again and see if I can recruit him. And I still have not gotten the collectible item from those, was it Grandpa Holly's? I believe that's their name. And I'm going to try and fight around a little bit. I might do some off-screen fighting as well. I don't get it from this fight, you just kind of keep proceeding south. Because this region, or this little area here, is a very small area, but has a lot of collectibles in it for whatever reason. And they're rare, and I think they're missable as well. Because I think late in the game, if you get too far in the game, I think the encounters here change. I'm not 100% sure on that, but definitely want to try and get that while you're here. Get all the collectibles while you're here as soon as you can. And I'm probably going to do that off screen if I don't get it on my way through here normally. Which, we've already gotten through here normally. Hey, buddy. Can I talk to you? Nope. No dialogue because you're not actually supposed to get that close to him. If I walk backwards, you're taking the domain of the Knights Matilda. If you know a fish business, I'm going to ask you to leave. And we turn around and walk away. Certainly didn't mind me walking right past you from the other direction, guys, but eh. A glitch caused by another glitch of sequence breaking and all that. Anywho, we're going to head back to Green Hill, which is just follow this road to the southwest, and we'll be there. And Muse is off to the east, and that's the direction we'll be going after this episode is over. Definitely want to make sure to save here real quick. Okay, we're going to try and abuse the rare find items glitch as well to try and get a certain rune from a shop here. And you might wonder where the rune shop is. Not in the main town, but if you come back here, you'll enter the Green Hill Academy. This is a college town, and over here there's a rune sage classroom. Talk to this guy, though, and he's a runemaster trainee. And he actually has his own little runemaster shop. Yeah, this is the item I wanted to get. By the way, speaking of money, you get a lot if you do a lot of fighting in the Matilda region, which is why I've been able to afford as much of the stuff as I can. You also get pixie and kite runes from this guy, if you so desire it. Essentially, abilities that allow you to attack or put on a staff and use various attacks. Put a pixie rune on a staff and they can attack from the back row, even though staff users do crap damage 99% of the time. Kite rune allows a bow user or a throwing weapon user to attack all enemies on the field for half damage. Both are good, but I don't think we really have anyone who I'd really like to give to. We got someone who we're going to recruit pretty soon, or two people we will be able to recruit pretty soon, but I don't think I really need to put any of those runes on them. Instead, we're pretty much done here, in fact. So, what I'd like to do, actually, now that I've actually talked to Elsie Chan, I kind of want to head back to the forest village and see if Wakaba will join me. Because that's one of those weird deals where I believe Wakaba will not join you unless you've talked to Elsie Chan. And I think by talking to him in Matilda, or Rockax Castle, I believe that'll be of enough of a trigger to allow me to recruit Wakaba here. So we're going to try and make this all one video, and see if we can recruit her and her master, and show a bunch of all this glitchy stuff off in one video. Hey there, Ryu. Yep, my master hasn't come back. Alright, so talking to him at Rockax was not enough of a trigger, unfortunately. Maybe it was, I'm not entirely sure. Maybe there's another castle level requirement or something like that, I don't know. But I know you can recruit her at some point in time pretty early on in the game. I think you need to be a certain level, or I don't know what it was. I'm probably going to have to look it up off screen. But once you have Wakaba, you can recruit Long Chan Chan. And by doing all that, we could get two more strong party members at an early point in time in the game. And that's kind of a benefit for all the sequence breaking. Alright, speaking of which, I had something I wanted to say before the Harpy fight. And I probably will just shoehorn it here at the end of this video as we're walking back to Muse. I will be going back to Matilda and going back to the forest pathway between Muse and Greenhill to try and get that one last collectible. I'll tell you what it is right now. Those Grandpa Hollies drop a potato seed. Yes, we're going to be getting a farm eventually, so seeds will be used for our farm, which go hand in hand with our cooking system that we'll be getting later. So, already getting a sneak preview using this glitch, but yeah, the other thing I was going to say about all this sequence breaking, I'm probably going to get called out by a lot of people on this, or maybe eventually I will be, and once again, I feel like I still need to justify doing all this, because, well, I'm not doing everything in a very traditional walkthrough sort of way. I'm doing this just because it's fun for me to do it this way, because believe it or not, in about the dozen or so times I've played through this game, I have never done this glitch this early in the game. I've done the glitch before, just kind of see how it works, but I've never actually done it at the beginning of the game like this. I mean, we still are at the point where Victor is like, hey, go out and get some recruits. Well, I guess we did here in the Highway Village. We got Humphrey and Futch. And they would know each other and all that because they were all in the first game. But, yeah, I've never actually done the Muse-Matilda border glitch this early in the game and just over-leveled myself to the max and given myself all this good gear like the Dragon Armor and Thunder Amulets. And if I'm not mistaken, there's a good item in the item shop here as well. And I'm doing this just for my own replay value more than anything. And just to kind of show the world what the game is like. If you do the Muse-Matilda border glitch at such an early point in the game. Yep, this is an item you can buy as much of as you want. The Fire Emblem. Very good game series, by the way. also get shoulder pads, defensive side. Nothing in comparison to what we got already. If I'm not mistaken, Fire Emblems are equipable only by male characters, which is why Nanami can't equip it. Might as well give one to everyone as long as we can afford it. I'm only going to give one to everyone. Put the fur cape in the bag. I want to sell that because that's stronger defensively overall. Futch, currently a Fire Emblem. So he's got a Fire Emblem and a Thunder Amulet. And these are a favorite item of mine in Suikoden 3, by the way. Okay, so I think I'll give the fur cape to Humphrey. There we go, okay. Yeah. Actually, he's got Thunder Amulet, so we'll do it this way. Okay. Alright, I think at this point, I suppose, we're at a good stopping point, so I'll go back and get that potato seed and call it a day. So, thanks for watching.